Okay, happy Sabbath, everyone. It's always wonderful to be in the courts of the Lord. It's a blessing when we come together to say, thank you, Jesus. We have one more day of life, one more opportunity when we can praise you. You know, we've been studying about the Psalms, and one of the gentlemen who wrote some wonderful words of comfort and praise was called Asaph. And this week we saw his name coming up quite a bit, and you know, I remember one important psalm he talked about where he was going through some troublous times, and he said, until, it was Psalm 73, he said, until he went into the sanctuary, he understood their end. So there's something that happens when you come into the sanctuary of God. There's some understanding that comes to your heart when you enter the sanctuary of God. And he also said in that verse 28 of Psalm 73, it is good to draw near to God. Today is my pleasure to welcome us to Mount Gilead as we try to draw near to God and also to draw near to brothers and sisters of like mind. So I extend a hearty welcome to each and every person present here today. We extend a hearty welcome also to those who are online. Some people are on YouTube. We have other persons who are on Zoom, and I know that they have the same mindset that, yes, they're coming to draw near to God and to be in his presence. So welcome to Mount Gilead. You know, we do have some special persons we'd like to make mention of today. And as I call your name, just give us a wave. Okay, give us a little wave. We have Fernando Rios, who is from Brazil. Okay, wonderful, Fernando. He was here pretty early. Nice to have you with us. We have Naneem James. Okay, beautiful. Carol's friend, wonderful. From Dominica, okay. Naneem from Dominica. And Kiana Jackson. Okay, praise the Lord. You notice they're all sitting on that side. There must be some special warmth on that side. Sister Carol, you're the one. They're pretty close to you. But Elder Shaw. Oh, he's the one they're drawing close to. You see, we're here to draw close to God, but we also draw close to the elders, Elder Shaw and Sister Carol, and all the brothers and sisters, because I'm sure that all of us will reach out to them, even during the break time, and say, welcome to Mount Gilead. It was nice to have you here. So I hope we have a wonderful time. We welcome Sister Ardeen, and also we will hear about Elder Pike a little later. She's our special guest for today, who will present the word of the Lord. So have a wonderful Sabbath, everyone, and let the Holy Spirit blaze in your heart as we seek to be drawing closer to God. We do have a few announcements to present at this time, and the first thing is about the birthdays. This week we had Amarissa, that was Pastor Reed's daughter, is Pastor Reed's daughter, who was a member. She is a member of our church still, but no longer physically visiting here because, you know, Pastor has duties all over the conference. We also have Daland. And Daland, proudly from last week, he was raising his hand. God bless you, Daland. He's a faithful young man in the sanctuary of the Lord, serving wherever he can. We have Sister Josephine. I'm not sure if she's here today. Sister Josephine Johnson, but when you see her, just wish her a happy birthday, because today is her birthday. Do you see that date, the 9th? So it's a special day in Zion. We always rejoice when we see someone celebrating a birthday, especially on Sabbath. So, Sister Christine's son. Okay, well, send me the name so I can add him to the list. Wonderful. So we're not going to sing happy birthday. We do that once per month. But continue to greet them and say, it's nice to see you. And thank God you're 1 year older and wiser and 1 year closer to the kingdom of God. Okay, we continue with our announcements as we remind you that today is the start of our week of prayer. It is not just local to Mount Gilead, but it's a global week of prayer. And Metro East actually has some events you might have seen in the OCN. But Mount Gilead Youth, they will be having some presentations during this week. So you see March 9 to 16. Remember, tomorrow night at 7 p.m., Monday night at 7 p.m., Wednesday and Friday at 7 p.m., we invite you all to come onto Zoom and support our young people as they make the presentations. And remember, it's a time for prayer, not just to hear a presentation, so let's keep praying. Other important events you will see as time goes on, keep close to the news presentations that we present. We also have our Youth Day next week, the 16th, Global Youth Day. That will be the closing of the week of prayer, and we're having a fellowship lunch, I think, on that day. Oh, the fellowship lunch is canceled, so erase that thought. Okay. So let's continue to celebrate with our youth throughout this week. I will just remind you also that those of you who are in charge of submitting master schedule information, the second quarter is almost here, begins next month. So we need that information. So please submit your master schedule information to Elder Shaw or myself, or both of us preferably. And we will, by the 20th of March, in order for the schedule to be fully organized and set up before the end of this month. Okay, so continue to have a blessed Sabbath. I invite Elder Ainsworth at this time, who will talk about some Pathfinder fundraising project. And then you will hear from Pastor Reed.
That is Pastor Lindo, yes. Thank you, Elder Yvonne. Okay, I'm here for just a couple of minutes, a couple of seconds. Because I want to show you in person what the sweatshirt that I spoke about last week, what it looks like. It has the Mount Gilead name on the back and SDA. And then you also have the mountain, which is a little bit different than the hands. On the side, on this one, on the side sleeve, right-hand side, there's a Toronto. So that if you go out of town and you wear it, people know at least what city you're from, okay? And this one is an extra large. So you can judge by your size what size you want to order, okay? I'm normally a large, and I'm trying on the extra large. So I'm extra large now. But yeah, and the good thing about it is it's gonna be zipped up in the front. We have some that are overhead, but this one, you zip it up. So that way, if you're a little bit hot, you can zip it down. Or if you're cold, you lift it up and it has the hoodie. Okay, so that's number one. And the last one is we're still looking for our venue for our multicultural event that we're gonna be having. We see people from all over the world that's here in our church. We wanna celebrate your part of the world, your country, your island. So we're asking that you keep it in mind. It's gonna be, I'm hoping that we can get it next month, because sun is setting really later as you go into the months ahead. So we want to have it where we can have a lot of time together. You know, maybe you can sing your national anthem, you can display your country's flag, you could talk or put something together about your country. And then also we want the food section, and we're going to try and sell the tickets, and then people can come to your booth and try your food. So that's the general idea of it. And we're just looking for a good venue to have it at. And hopefully everything will run perfectly well. Pastor, thank you very much.
I'm Pastor Lindo. Just want to remind you to make sure that you don't think I'm a different pastor. Still Pastor Lindo. I want to thank all those who have attended a funeral yesterday at Sister Sheikh's. It was a blessing and it was good to see all the folks there yesterday. It was good. And let's remember to support the family. Just don't leave them alone. Call them and let them know that you care for them. The other thing I want to mention is this book. You know, somebody was visiting here from St. Lucia and heard about this. And so they ordered one book. And it made such an impact upon this individual's life that she purchased about six copies and gave it to other individuals. And one of the ladies that she gave it to, her father just died. And she said that this could not have come at a better time. So I hope you are reading this book. I hope you're reading it. And if there are anyone here today that did not receive one, that I believe that you can have a copy. Is there anyone that didn't receive one? Okay, there's one person back there. And you know what? I'm going to give a copy to our visit. Oh, you didn't receive one either? Okay. I want to give her that one. And I'm going to, I'll come with this one in a minute. And I'm going to give a copy to our visitor who came from Brazil. You speak English, right?
Okay, thank you very much.
Jada.
Good morning. Please stand. We gather today to worship the one who created us, the one who calls us, the one who equips us, the one who loves us without end. With joyful hearts, let us worship God. Mangayad, this is your call to worship.
We have come into his house.
We have come into his house and gathered in his name to worship him. We have come into his house and gathered in his name to worship him. We
thank you for this, your holy Sabbath day. We thank you for the opportunity to come into your house and to worship you and to praise you for all that you have done and all that you are. And I pray, dear Father, that as we begin this service this morning, that Father, your Holy Spirit would just abide with us here. May we feel the sweet love and the anointing of the Holy Spirit, dear Father. And may we leave here blessed today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please remain standing as we sing our opening hymn, number 71, Come Thou Almighty King. As we go into this season of prayer, God is indeed here.
There is a sweet anointing in the sanctuary.
Possible, or bow our heads reverently as we pray. Dear kind and heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much for this precious and holy Sabbath day that you've placed and set aside for us to honor you, to glorify you as our Creator, our Father, and our friend. Help us, each individual here, to keep this day holy in our thoughts, words, and deeds. Lord, we are thankful for each person who is here today. You know the week that they had, and you know the trials, the joys, and all that they went through. And I thank you, Lord, that you have made it so that they could be here today to worship together as a church family. Father, we thank you so much for your love toward us. Thank you for your faithfulness and all that you provide. As I petition upon your throne of grace for your people, I ask that you will cleanse and forgive me of my sins. I pray that you will hear this prayer, that it may go up to you untainted, and that you may answer according to your will and in your perfect timing. Lord, we pray for our church leaders. You know that they have a hard task leading the various flocks you have assigned them. And I pray, Father, that we will continue to pray for them, that they will be faithful and committed to your word. And when they make mistakes, Lord, help us not to condemn and criticize, but to pray even more fervently that they will stay strong in you. I pray for our church congregation here in Mount Gilead. I pray for each member who may be sick at this time, not only physically, Father, but mentally, emotionally, and spiritually. You know what they are going through. You know that they may be in discomfort, but I pray that you will give them a peace that surpasses all understanding. I pray for those who are still grieving at this time, who have lost loved ones. Be close to them, Father. Hold them with your loving arms and let them know that you will never leave them nor forsake them. I pray for our youth as we begin this Youth Week of Prayer. Place a hedge of protection around them. There are so many things in this world out here to distract and to destroy. But I pray that you will protect them, protect their minds, and help them not to be ashamed to stand apart, not to be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Help us, Lord, to surround them with love, to help them along the way, and to hold their hands. I pray for the speaker of the hour, Elder Pike. You have given her a word to speak to the congregation at this time, and I ask that your Holy Spirit will fill her and that we will hear directly from your throne room. I also pray and thank you for the visitors we have here today. May all of us, after the hearing of your word, be drawn closer to you. We thank you so much for what you will do through us and what you will help us to do, Lord, in this community here that you have placed us in. Thank you, Father, for hearing us and for answering our prayers. In Jesus' name I pray with thanksgiving. Amen.
We come before the presence of God, we expect to sing. We expect to praise. The Bible says, come before his presence with singing. And we always welcome when we get visitors singing and glorifying God. Today we have a sister from Toronto East, Sister Ardine Taff. She has sung for us quite a few times. And today she's gracing us with her presence again, as God has blessed her with a voice that will present a message in song. So we invite Sister Ardine at this time for special music, and later on you'll hear from her again for the music of meditation.
Happy Sabbath, Mount Gilead. We've been studying Psalms, and when I think of Psalms, I think of grace, because regardless of our rebellion and our stepping away from God, he extends grace towards us and welcomes us back. And for that reason, I'm going to sing this song, Were It Not for Grace.
not be lost. Worry it not for grace. I can tell you where I'd be, wandering down some pointless road to nowhere. My salvation up to me, and I know how that would go.
Everyone, it's Aunt Fernita. Today's story is called A New World. The memory verse is from Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. It says, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth." Today's message is, "God is love," is written upon all He has made. Have you ever been in a very dark place? No light anywhere. That is just what it was like when God began to create our world. God looked at the dark, watery space. It was time to put His plans for Earth into motion. Then God said, "Let there be light." And suddenly there was a bright light. God separated the light from the darkness. He called the light day and the darkness night. This was the first day of creation. God looked around. Water covered everything. He spoke, and the waters divided, forming the sky. This was the second day of creation. God looked at the watery world. He said, "Let the water under the sky be separated, and let dry ground appear." As He spoke, it happened. God called the waters seas and the dry ground land. God looked at the land and the seas, and He saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let the land produce vegetation, seed-bearing plants and trees on the land that bear fruit with seed in it, according to their various kinds." And it was so. God looked at the plants and the trees and saw that it was good. This was the third day of creation. God looked up at the sky. "Let there be lights in the heavens to separate the day and the night," He said. "They will light the earth and mark seasons, days, and years." God made two great lights. The sun was the brighter light to shine during the day. The moon was the weaker light to shine at night. God also made the stars. He looked at the sun, the moon, and the stars and saw that it was good. This was the fourth day of creation. God said, "Let the seas and the rivers be filled with living creatures. Let birds fill the air with their songs." God looked at all the creatures that live in the water. He watched the birds. "That's good," He said. God blessed them and said, "Be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the seas, the rivers, and the sky." This was the fifth day of creation. God said, "Let the land produce living creatures, livestock, creatures that move along the ground, and wild animals." God looked at them and saw that they were good. Then God said, "Let us make people in our image. They will rule over the fish of the sea, the birds, the livestock, the animals that creep on the ground, and all living things." God created man and woman. God blessed them, saying, "Be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and rule over it. I give you all the seed-bearing plants and fruits of the trees for food. I give every creature, every green plant for food." God looked at everything he had made, and it was very good. This was the sixth day of creation. God made the world in 6 days. When he finished making it beautiful, he gave it to Adam and Eve to care for. God still gives us wonderful gifts today because he loves us. When we see the wonderful things in nature, let's remember that God's love is shown by the things he has made.
Amen. Just to let you know that it's Youth Day. That's why I'm up here. Okay? Amen. Amen? Amen? All right. Just in case you didn't know. All right. Just wanted to recognize the presence of Kenaya with us this morning. Thanks for coming by. We both were in Belize together ministering just last year, so it's good that you could pop in today. Amen? All right. Oh, our offertory today is going to be about a very powerful tool that is used for winning souls. The Adventist World Radio, AWR. All Adventists should know about that, shouldn't we? Yes. So AWR uses many forms of technology to reach people where they are in their local dialect. From AWR's shortwave towers in Guam to 1,800 radio stations around the world, these messages are broadcasting in more than 130 languages every day. I thought I'd get an amen there. And for those who aren't in range of a radio station, AWR's YouTube videos and ministry apt are ministering to millions. Recently, the ministry tried something unique in Ghana. After renting air time on 10 radio stations near the Sahara Desert, AWR started sharing the good news of the gospel over marketplace loudspeakers in 12 cities. AWR also paired this with a question of the day, where callers were invited to receive a prize, such as a copy of the book, The Great Controversy, by answering a question about the prior day's broadcast. Listen to this, brethren. The results have already been astounding. In the last six months, more than 10,000 people have been baptized, with approximately 5,000 from the market loudspeakers alone. God predicted that one day the world, we would be utterly amazed, Habakkuk 1:5, at what he would do. And we are amazed, aren't we? Thank you for your support to Adventist World Radio. the Holy Spirit, which we have been focusing on this quarter, has done amazing work around the world. We should never think that we can't do the same thing here in Mount Gilead Seventh-day Adventist Church. Amen? And so we look forward to the day when that will begin to manifest itself in just how we operate and carry out the ministry. I'm going to ask us to bow our heads as we pray, and following that, I'm going to invite you to take your offerings and your tithe to the receptacles that are provided in the passage, in the aisle. Great God and our Father, we pause to give you thanks, not only for the fact that we have been blessed and you have afforded us the privilege to return your tithe and contribute an offering that will help to spread your gospel around the world, including this city, in Toronto. We pray, God, that again, we understand that you, through your divine wisdom and provision, will partner with us in reaching people. And so today we submit ourselves to you and ask that you accept our offerings. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. You may proceed to was about to give way to our next young presenter, youth, but I come along, my other youth. but I just saw someone in our congregation, Brother Brown. Brother Brown, stand up so the brethren can see you. Amen. They've been asking for you, and you told me this week that you'll try and make it to church today, and we're so happy that you did. God bless you. Now please pay attention to the next youth.
Because age is just a number. So today I'm a 19-year-old, and I'm going to ask you to stand as I bring you the scripture reading. Then Jesus, it's taken from Matthew chapter 9, verses 35 and 36. Then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in the synagogues, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every sickness and every disease among the people. But when he saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion for them, because they were weary and scattered, like sheep having no shepherd. This is the word of the Lord. Please be seated. Thank you.
Okay, praise be to God. I'm one of those wannabe youth, but I'm here to introduce a real youth. Okay. Today we have a young lady who has preached here before. She has blessed her heart. Elder Kamisha Pike, she's from Perth Seventh-day Adventist Church. And God has laid a message on her heart to present to start our Youth Week of Prayer. Kamisha is very thankful for life more abundantly through Jesus Christ. She currently serves as an elder for a women's ministry and greeters. She's a part of the AV team. So of course, you know, we would have loved her. And she assists with the AY department at Perth Seventh-day Adventist Church. She's a graduate of Ryerson University, the class of 2016, where she earned a Bachelor of Commerce in Retail Management. After a two-year battle with anxiety and depression during her second and third years of university, God revealed himself to Kenesha in a mighty way, and she became certain of his call on her life. Since then, Kenesha has enjoyed teaching and leading small groups, helping others grow in their walk with God, serving in local church, and sharing the gospel message through preaching and writing. Her interests include reading books, cooking, working on creative projects, exploring new places, and spending some time with friends and family. Her favorite Bible verse is Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. I know God has directed her path, so today she's at Mount Gilead, the best place to be on this Sabbath day. And we pray that as she comes forward, that you will open your hearts, that you too will be tremendously blessed. Before Elder Kenesha comes, we have some singing. We're going to be singing, 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 and then shouting, shouting, praise the Lord. But Sister Charlene and her team, Sister Lena, they will be leading us in two praise songs. So sing along with them as we praise God. And then we will have our music of meditation by Sister Arlene once more. Ardine, thank you.
You know, in lesson study this morning, it says we have to sing the praises of God. And so this morning, we're going to sing two hymns, 511 followed by 512. They said, I know whom I have believed, followed by just when I need him most. And so let us sing and give God thanks.
I know not by God's wondrous grace to me he hath made known, nor by unworthy Christ in love redeemed me for his own.
But I know
whom I have believed, and I'm persuaded that he is able.
just when I need him most. He is what? He is always there. Just when I falter, just when I fear, ready to help me, he's ready to cheer. Just when I need him most. Just when I need him, Jesus is near. Just when I falter, just when I fail. Ready? Ready to help me, ready to cheer. Just when I need him most. Just when I need him, Jesus is true. Never forsake him. All the way through. Giving for burdens. Giving for burdens. Pleasures are new. Just when I need him most. Just when. Just when I need him most. Just when I need him most, Jesus is near to comfort and cheer. Just when I need him most. Just when I need him, Jesus is strong. That song in your heart, that just when you need him, he is always there. Thank you.
Happy Sabbath. Happy Sabbath, everyone. It's a blessing to be here this morning, or afternoon rather. I'm looking at the time. Even though it's rainy outside, thank God that it's bright on the inside. No? Thank you, Elder Shah, once again, for the invitation. It's great to be back here again, and just a blessing, especially on this Youth Week of Prayer to begin. So I'm ready to share this message. Does God love your city? It's an interesting one, and the theme for Youth Week of Prayer is actually show up in the cities. And I believe that as followers of Christ, this is our everyday mandate. This is what we should be doing regardless. Think this is who we are naturally as people. And so I just wanna, if you wanna stand with me this afternoon as we reread the scripture reading, Matthew chapter 9, verse 35 to 36. And the scripture says, then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every sickness and every disease among the people. But when he saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion for them, because they were weary and scattered like sheep having no shepherd. Father in heaven, this is your time. Thank you for your word, dear Lord, and I pray that as the word goes forth, that God, you would grant us wisdom, understanding, and inspiration, Lord. I pray that our hearts and our minds would be open to receive what it is that you would have us to hear, Lord. How it is that we can love and impact this city for you. I pray, oh God, that these words would be a blessing, Lord, and that we would not leave here empty, but full of your grace, full of your love, and full of your spirit. Bless these words in Jesus' name. Amen. So, for my whole life, the whole 30 years of my life, I have lived in Toronto. I love the tall buildings, the lights at night, the multiculturalism, which has allowed me to have friends from various different countries from across the world. That I am thankful for. I love Yonge and Dundas Square, which is probably one of my favorite places to go. It is one of, if not the heartbeat of the city. Growing up, I used to just love going down there, and I would just stand in the middle of all the action. I remember when I was at school at Ryerson and they built the special crossing, so you could cross diagonally and vertically and everything, and I absolutely loved that. I love just people watching, seeing people going to work or coming from work. Same thing with school, catching the streetcar, hearing some live music. And even there was a man who, I'm not even sure if he's still there, I think he might be, but he would always be standing at the corner saying, believe in the Lord. He's still there, okay. Thank you for the confirmation. And on TV, in the movies, Toronto is portrayed as this glamorous, bustling, vibrant city, similar to New York. So you could say it's the Canadian version of New York, in a sense. But, I'm sure as we all know, it isn't always what it looks like as seen on TV. Because the further you go downtown, or in certain areas, certain corners of the city, the more that you see. And it's not always something positive. As much as I love the museums and the various cityscapes of Toronto, there are a lot of things about this city that makes me sad. Like the homeless people I see every time I get off at certain subway stations. They're usually lying down on some sort of grate that has heat generating out of it just to stay warm, usually wrapped in a sleeping bag and some blankets. There's the constant traffic that sometimes makes it impossible for you to get anywhere on time and anywhere without being super stressed. It's the news of housing prices and rent going up as inflation inflates, and it gets more expensive for people to live in the city. And you see people are often displaced from their homes. I don't like seeing those who are mentally ill and they're wandering the streets with no sense of direction because they're just lost. They don't even know themselves. And you see them and it kind of sounds like, you know, they're weary and they're scattered, like sheep having no shepherd. Where have we heard that? Probably heard it in scripture. And so with all of these things mentioned, I know I love my city, I do. But does God love our city? And I'll say that yes, he does. He absolutely does, which means that he loves the people that live in them, including you and me. These are people with diverse backgrounds and cultures and experiences and issues, but he loves them just the same. The cities are full of people from different walks of life who are still made in his image. And so my first point is this, is that God loves our city because he understands what it means to grow up in one. And what do I mean by this? Remember the story of Jesus. Remember that Jesus is the Son of God. He was the very picture, the very reflection of who God is. And in the Bible, we see that Jesus grew up in a small village, a small town called Nazareth. And in John chapter 1, verse 46, the question was asked, can any good thing come out of Nazareth? See, it wasn't a celebrated place or it wasn't highly memorable. It was actually the complete opposite of Toronto. And it really reminds me of smaller neighborhoods within our city that are seen as trouble or insignificant. Places like Jane and Finch, Jamestown, Flemingdon Park, Regent Park, Moss Park, Parma Court, even some areas in Scarborough. These places are unfortunately known for having high crime, poor living conditions, and poverty, sadly. And socially, we can see that similar to Nazareth, these places weren't really the best places to live for people to be. But I'm thankful that even though we and others may have grown up in insignificant places, that God is able to bring significance to those places. The small town upbringing was no match for the glory of God through Jesus. God is able to bring great glory out of small spaces. See, fast forward a little bit to the resurrection. And in Mark 16:6, when the disciples were coming to look for Jesus, and the angel was standing by at the tomb, and he said, but he said to them, do not be alarmed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He is risen, he is not here. But see the place where they laid him. See, Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified, had risen. And so there was no longer shame in his name. So where the town of Nazareth was the name that caused Jesus' name to have shame upon it, after rising from the dead, that was no more. So that threw some shade in the faces of Jesus' enemies. And this is the same Jesus who, in our key text, is the one who went about all the cities and villages teaching, preaching, and healing. Those are three main things. He didn't allow the small upbringing to confine him, nor was he intimidated by the bad reputation that some of these towns may have had. And he does the same for the people in Toronto today, and he shows his love towards them. He immerses himself in every aspect of their lives, even if they don't recognize it, and he gives them hope. And as one who dwells in the city, we have the opportunity to shine and share him with others. This story, this example of Jesus in, you know, growing up in Nazareth and thinking of the different places in Toronto that don't have the best reputation remind me of Steve Anderson, who was actually a member at my church and was elected as Shelburne's first racialized person to become deputy mayor and a regional councillor. See, Steve was a child of Jamaican immigrants, and he grew up in Jane and Finch. But he navigated his way through the community with surgical precision to avoid getting into trouble. And even though he grew up in a community like Jane and Finch with a reputation for drugs and violence, Steve was determined to make something better of his life. And he always had one of his teachers in his corner to plant the seed, to beat the stereotypes and the biases and the prejudices to achieve his degree, to become something significant. And while working at the TTC, where he was actually hired as the first Black lawyer, he began empowering youths in the Jane and Finch community. And most recently, he did release his book, Driven to Succeed, from the infamous Jane and Finch community to the privileged seats of Town Hall. So it doesn't matter where we come from, what parts of the city we are in. It's the fact that God still loves us. He still loves the people of Toronto, despite where these people are inhabiting, despite the conditions that they're currently living in. So God loves our city because he understands what it means to grow up in one and what it means to feel as though the people around you, the name of the neighborhood that you're in is the thing that defines you. But because of Jesus, that doesn't have to be. Because of who we believe, we can be better. We can be people that reflect him and his glory. My second point is this: God loves our city so much that he has sent messengers to declare his love for us and what he's able to do. He sent messengers to declare in the form of even evangelists, people who testify of him. And going back to the key verse, Matthew 9, verse 35, which says, "Then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every sickness and every disease among the people." The Bible tells us a story in Luke chapter 8, verse 26 to 39, where a demon-possessed man was healed. And when this man saw Jesus, he fell down before him, and Jesus commanded the demon, the unclean spirit, to come out of him. And that demon departed from the man, and the man begged to stay with Jesus. But Jesus' answer to him was, in verse 39, "Return to your own house and tell what great things God has done for you." And so the man went out and he proclaimed throughout the whole city what great things Jesus had done for him. And so wherever we are, there are people in and all over the city who need to hear how much God has done for us and how much he is able to do for them. People need to hear that he is a God who loves, who saves, who heals, and delivers. And although the city has its challenges, we need to see the opportunities. We need to see the opportunities. I think sometimes we focus too much on the negative, that we don't see the positives. And really the positive here is for people to know God and to be loved by him. I want to share that back when I was in school, I believe this was around 2015, and I was doing evangelism with my school campus group at the time, and we went to UFT, and we were sharing about an upcoming event called Why Does God Allow Suffering? And we had flyers that we were handing out. We were trying to share it and just let people know that this event was going to be happening, and that if they had questions, they could come and ask us and just encourage them. And in the process of going around and sharing these flyers, there was a student with a visible disability who came to me, and I could just tell that she was very troubled. And she started telling me about her struggles with anxiety. And one interaction with her, and this is what I will never forget, is that she asked me if my God could heal her of her anxiety. And I told her, yes, he absolutely can. And that also gave me the opportunity to share my own story of how 2 years prior, I myself struggled with anxiety and depression, and how God healed me of it, and how just through his word, through prayer, through counseling, just daily seeking him and reading about peace in the word of God, and trusting that God was able to really give me the peace that I so desired, just all of that is what allowed me to draw closer to him and allowed me to see him for who he really was, and to accept that, yes, he is able to heal and to deliver my mind and my spirit. So that's a classic example of sharing what he has done for us. And truly, God loves our city. He does. And he does this by, like I said, sending messengers and even evangelists. We sometimes will look at evangelists as those who come up and they do evangelistic series. But not only so, we are evangelists. We have the message. We have the word. We have the testimony. And so we can be lights and testify of God and testify for him. And finally, God loves our city and desires for people in the cities to be redeemed and to live in a better city with him one day. He wants to point them to a better city than what they are seeing before them and living in now. In Hebrews 11, verse 10, we are told that there is a city to come which has foundations whose builder and maker is God. It's not the foundations that we see, just the regular concrete, where, you know, every summer there's construction and the road is being torn up and all of that. No, it's a sure foundation, and that foundation is God. And going down a few verses to verse 16, same Hebrews 11, we read that the heroes of faith desired a better, that is, a heavenly country. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. And that makes me excited, because just even as Christians, as those who know God, but how much more so those who don't even know. Imagine what telling someone this, that there's a better city for you. You may not see it, but it's a city that you can't even imagine. That's such a wonderful thought that our minds can't even fathom how great heaven will be. But it's just knowing that we have a much better home, a much better city to look forward to, one that will not corrupt, one that will be undefiled, and one that will be reserved just for us. And the same hope is available for those unreached people who live in the cities too. Right now, if you go downtown to Young Dundas Square, some places on Queen, maybe around Spadina, under the Gardner, near the waterfront where Lake Ontario is, you'll find a lot of tent cities. You'll find a lot of homeless people, people doing everything they can to find a home. Statistics tell us that there's over 9,000 people who are homeless, and with 77% of those homeless people being without a home for more than 6 months. That's a lot of people. And the number is growing. The number is growing. These individuals desire a home. And the Lord has a special message for them in John 14, verse 1 to 3. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. So he is the God who can not only provide a physical home, but a spiritual home and an eternal home to come. He wants to make his home in our hearts, but also in the hearts of the people that live in Toronto. Going again through the city, as I mentioned, there's a lot of traffic. We've got the DVP, the 401, the Gardiner Expressway. You've got gridlock of people who are just stuck, unable to move. And unfortunately, that's a reflection of some people that live within the city. That is their current state of life, is that they literally feel stuck in their lives with no sense of purpose, no sense of being. And although the city itself is moving at a fast pace, they're not. They're just there and they're slow moving. And so while the TTC, our good old Toronto Transit Commission, the slogan is the better way, I will say TJC, trust Jesus Christ, the way, the truth, and the life. Because he will get you through the tough, standstill moments of life and have you moving forward with his love, his grace, and his guiding care. Mental health is another crisis. With CAMH, I remember speaking to a representative who had set up a booth in a mall that I was at recently, and the individual was expressing to me the long wait times for assessments and for medications, that people have to wait up to 2 years sometimes just for assessment. And even if they do get assessed, the medication that they need isn't always available. And that's another wait time. So imagine all of these conditions and all of these things that people are struggling with that are just going untreated, and they just wander. According to CAMH, mental illness and substance abuse disorders account for between 11 and 15% of Ontario's disease burden. And sadly, it only receives about 7% of healthcare dollars. That is very low. And that is very hopeless for people who really and truly need the help. And so pointing people to the city to come means they can look forward to a day where there will be no more addictions, no more need for medication, no more mental breakdowns, no more sorrow, because all those things will be passed away. Revelation 21, verse 2 to 5 reminds us of this beautiful reality. John says, "Then I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from heaven saying, 'Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them. And they shall be his people. God himself will be with them and be their God. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There should be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away.' Then he who sat on the throne said, 'Behold, I make all things new.' And he said to me, 'Write, for these words are true and faithful.'" It's going back to verse 3, "Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people." Such an important and just this sense of ownership, this sense of love, this sense of care. And when I pray for the people of this city, that's what I desire for them, that they will know that the God that I serve can also be their God, and that He can dwell with them. He can find His home with them. And I always think of that when I walk by and I see people without homes, when I walk by shelters, or I go and I serve and I give sandwiches, and you just see the crowds of people. And truly, Jesus is so moved with compassion towards these individuals. He doesn't just feel sorry for them, but He feels everything that they feel. And that's when I know that God loves our cities and the people within them. That's how I know. Because He desires so much for them. He desires their good, that He sends all of us to be able to be His hands and feet when these people need it the most. And so in the meantime, while they find shelter and they try to find resources to help them through, God wants the people in His cities to experience His peace that surpasses all understanding, and to know that He is their refuge and their strength, a very present help in their time of trouble. And so, in conclusion, we see that cities are places of influence. It's where great things happen, but also sadly where not so great things happen. Cities house a lot of people from different places and backgrounds, and God loves them all. God loves cities. He has such a heart for the cities and all who dwell in them. He Himself has dwelt in a city, and He sends messengers and evangelists like us to tell of His love, and He points people in the cities to a better city, one where they will always be with Him forever. And so as young people, as people of God, not only during this Youth Week of Prayer, but every day of our lives, we are called to love our cities the way God does. And just like Jesus in our key text, we have the opportunity to teach and to share about God's love. We too can preach the gospel, and we can point others to His healing power. We can show compassion, a deep concern and sympathy towards those in the cities who are struggling, and offer hope. So how do we show God's love in the cities? Well, we can share an encouraging word with someone while we walk down the street, or we're on the subway going to work, or we're in Tim Hortons and we're grabbing a bagel and a tea, whatever that looks like, wherever you are. We have an opportunity to share a word with someone. We can help by providing someone with a meal. We can also give money to help the poor or donate to help improve essential services in the city. We can volunteer at a shelter and see how people live from day to day. We can pray and ask God to help change our cities, and to give wisdom to the leaders that oversee the affairs of our city. Because that's another important thing too. Sometimes we forget to pray for the leaders in our cities as well. There is so much that we can do because we serve a big and mighty God whose love knows no end. And as we go through this Youth Week of Prayer, let's show up in our cities boldly for God and share His love. Does God love your city? Does God love my city? Yes, He does. And so I pray that God will add His richest blessings to these words, that we would be inspired to show up for Him boldly in the cities in these last days. Because there are so many unreached people that need to hear the gospel. People need the Lord. We hear that song all the time. Every day they pass us by, and we can see things in their eyes, broken people filled with pain, going who knows where. People need the Lord. People need the Lord. And so let's show up boldly in our cities for Him and show our cities that God loves them. Father in heaven, Lord, thank you for this message. Thank you, O God, for showing your love to the cities. Thank you for giving us the opportunities every day to be your hands and feet. Thank you for sending us, dear Lord, and allowing us to live in different parts of the cities, Lord, to be lights wherever we are. And I pray, O God, that as we move forward in our lives, that as you impress upon our hearts who to speak to, who to share your love with, that our answer would be, yes, Lord, I will go. I will show up in this city for you. Lord, we pray for our young people, dear Father. As we begin this Youth Week of Prayer, there are so many challenges and things that they struggle with on a day-to-day basis. Lord, I just ask that you would visit each and every young person at this time, and that, God, you would attend to their specific needs, that you would be with their families, O Lord, that you would touch their hearts and their minds and allow them to know your love for you. God, I pray for the city of Toronto, the city that I love, Lord, and I know the city that you love more than I do, more than we do. Because, Lord, when you created the world, even Toronto was created. The city of Toronto was even a part of your mind, even a part of your plan. And God, I just pray for the people within this city. I pray, oh God, that somehow, somewhere, they would be able to interact with someone, Lord, who would be able to share the love of God with them. I pray, oh God, that you would be with the leaders of our city, Lord, as they continue to conduct the everyday affairs, that, God, you would grant them wisdom, Lord, and that they, too, would even have an encounter with you, Lord, and that it would make an impact to all who live in this great city of Toronto. Lord, we just thank you, and we love you, and we ask for your continued blessing towards us, towards this city. In Jesus' name, amen.
Sobering message, isn't it? Now we're going to turn our attention to our young people. You know, we say all the time that we don't have a lot of young people in our church. But here is what, we do have young people in our church. So at this time, I'm going to invite Chantel to come forward and invite our young people to come up front. And I'm going to ask Chantel to do a special prayer for our young people. This week, it's their week. And I want us to emphasize that fact, that they are the future of this world and our church. So I'm going to invite all our young people to come forward as Chantel will do a special prayer for all our young people. By the way, I'm going to stand by them. Amen.
Okay, please bow your heads and close your eyes for prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you today with humble hearts, seeking your guidance and strength for the young people in our midst. We pray that you will grant them wisdom to make good choices, courage to stand firm in their faith, and a heart of compassion to share with those around them. Help them to seek after you with all their hearts and to find their identities and purpose in you. May they be the light of the world and shine brightly for your glory. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Thank you so much. You may return to your seats. And then Sister Charlene will continue.
I'm going to ask everyone to stand as we close off our service with the use of hymn 191, Love Divine.
Love divine, all love excelling, joy to heaven, earth come down, fix in us thy humble dwelling, all thy faithful mercies crown. Jesus, thou art all compassion,
once again for the word. Thank you for this service, dear Lord. Pray that as we depart from here, Lord, may we continue to hold the word in our hearts, to love the people in our cities, and to shine for you, to share the love of God to those we come in contact with. Thank you for your everlasting, unfailing love towards us. And I pray that as we leave here, dear Lord, your spirit and your blessings would continue to follow us. In Jesus' name, amen.
May his peace be with you till we meet again. May his peace be with you till we meet again. Till we reach that distant shore
may be seated. Have a good Sabbath, everyone.